All right, we're here to get one recorded. They might have liked, they powers that be must have liked the sound of my voice because they allowed that one to record. They probably figured, well, this dude's motivated to start saying some words. He's gonna get these on video whether we like it or not. With all due respect, you know, I have respect for those that want to follow the tetragrammatron knowledge, you know, and the tetragrammatron holds the power of eternal life, you know. Even though I'll sit here and say it don't. You know, but I'm not going to go out of my way to come to your door. Or if I see you on the street, I'm not going to go out of my way to say, hey, you know, hey, you believe the tetragrammatron? You're going to do that. You know, if it comes up naturally in a conversation and you're willing to hear what I have to say about it, or if it just, as we're conversating naturally and I decide to tell you, you know, it comes up and I say, nah, that ain't eternal life. And if you ask me why, and you're open to listening to what I have to say why about it, then I'll tell you. Other than that, I ain't gonna force it on you. I'm gonna bend your arm. I'm gonna push myself on you. It's just gonna be natural conversation, you know? But, anyway, so moving on. We'll have part two here and see if we get a part two out of this and see how this one takes. Have my little purple shirt on here today. Had my purpler on all week here. So, you know, I have respect for all these men that have been deceived by Satan and all, you know, all that they have to say about the flower of life and the tetragrammatron as they believe that it holds their eternal life. I have respect for these men, but, you know, I don't believe what they say. And I have respect for these men, seeing how they're in cahoots with the elite of the earth, you know, because the elite of the earth have gained control of the whole earth by defaulted bank loans through all the kings in history. They defaulted their bank loans to the Pope. They couldn't pay, in other words, they couldn't pay the Pope back, so the Pope said, okay, no problem, just give me your land, give me your people as slaves, I'll own everything, and I'll let you live and be the king, you know. But I'll own everything. So the king said, oh, okay, no problem. I at least want to be able to keep my throne. And so unbeknownst to all the people, you know, they didn't know what went down. So everybody's a slave, and the Vatican and the Pope, they own everything. They own all the space stations that revolve around the Earth, that study the sun and all the planets and everything. You know, that's their right. They've gained the control of everything through legitimate contract, through a bank loan, a defaulted bank loan. So it's agreement, just agreement between two men. You know, just so happens that the other man was a king who was in charge of a group of people in a landmass. And when the king lost everything he had, it went to the control of a new king called the Pope. Although the people didn't know what went down, right? And they weren't supposed to know because the Pope told the king not to tell him. And he said, if I catch you telling him, I'm gonna take off your leg and eliminate one of your family members. And so the king was like, my lips are sealed. My lips are sealed. Dun, dun. Break out the entertainment and have me some gestures and entertaining musicians. My lips are sealed. Dun, dun. But, you know, they have the right to live that life. That's what they want to do. And especially since how they control the whole earth, you know, they are to be honored and respected for that. They have legitimately gained control of everything through a defaulted bank loan, so they can do whatever the heck they want. And that includes harping the heck out of the earth and causing earthquakes and tsunamis and volcanoes. But, you know, it's my prayer that the Most High limits that, right? And so, and then, you know, and this, this, and that. And I can go into more details about that, about how I live my life and through the things that I do, you know, to help ensure that my prayers are somewhat answered in hopes, right? But that's a whole different subject. We can get into that. But anyway, they have the right to do all this stuff. They had the right to destroy Japan, right? Ain't nothing we can do about it. Ain't nothing we can say. They own it all. They own the people. They own the earth. It legitimately is a legitimate agreement, a legitimate contract. A contract is a contract on earth, legitimate. An agreement is just a tree. It's just a tree. They can do whatever they want. But I conduct my life in such a way, and the things that I do in life, to eliminate at least some of the bad things that I can do for the best of my ability, realizing that I can't do perfect, in hopes that the Most High will somehow, you know, honor my request that their destruction is limited. And I've noticed throughout my life that whenever I, you know, kind of slack off on some of the bad things I do in life, whenever I start slacking off, all of a sudden the destruction on earth starts increasing. And whenever I get a rein on myself and put a little more self-control on myself and start and quit slacking off, and all of a sudden things kind of go chill throughout the earth, and you know, everything kind of calms down and be quiet, right? So that's just between me and the Most High. That's how I see it. These are things that I've noticed in my life, throughout my life, believe it or not. So so I try hard at keeping myself from slacking off. So, and you know, doing bad things and being mean and stuff like that. Because I realize, you know, that, you know, whenever I start doing things like that, that the Most High kind of punishes me. And the way He punishes me is He punishes the people on the earth and the earth itself. To kind of let me know, hey, you know, you might want to control slacking off in that area a little bit more harder. And so it kind of opens my eyes and I go, oh, shoot, man, okay. You know, because the destructions just keep getting worse and worse every time I kind of allow myself to, you know, to venture into slacking off territory and start doing bad things and mean things, you know. So, knowing full well that I can't be perfect, and there's going to be times where, you know, it's going to be a hard struggle, man. But if you know where I'm coming from, but yeah, so as I was able to cover that subject, so we just covered it. But yeah, the Tetragrammatron, man, the flower of life, eh. That's just creation. That's just the pattern of creation. You know. And it's nice to know all that knowledge about the Tetragrammatron, you know. It's nice to be able to fly through the galaxy and fly through space and all that. But why are they doing it? They're doing something for the wrong reason. And although it's something legitimate to do, it's all being done for the wrong reason. And that's the difference that gets a man his eternal life. He's doing something that he thinks is going to get him his eternal life, but what he's doing is something that's, you know, somewhat okay to do, but he's doing it for the wrong reason. In other words, he's loving his neighbor like he loves himself. He's living his life, the conduct of his life, going around treating everybody right and good and doing good things. He's doing good things, but he's doing the right thing. He's being nice to everybody, right? He's doing the right thing, but he's doing it for the wrong reason. What's the wrong reason? The wrong reason is He's trying to love his neighbor as himself. And that's the law of Moses. That's the commandment. That's the commandment that lets us know that we can't be like the Most High. But if we realize that trying to be like the Most High is the sin, and that we no longer need to obey the commandments and to live our lives after them and to teach others to try to strive to live their lives after those 10 commandments. Right? Whenever we quit striving to live our lives to treat others as we'd like to be treated, whenever we quit striving after that knowledge from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, trying to be like the Most High, the knowledge that Satan tricked Eve into participating in, and Adam willfully participated in it, willfully laying down his life in hopes that the Most High would save him. When we participate in that knowledge, we're doing the right thing for the wrong reason. And that's a one-way ticket to eternal death. But once we know what the sin is, and we quit striving after living our lives after trying to be perfect, in other words, trying to treat others as we'd like to have them treat us, or, you know, the newfangled idea called karma, whenever we quit patterning our lives after what goes around comes around, whenever we quit living our lives after that, you know, then we're out from under the burden of eternal death. We're out from under the burden of the law. We're out from under the burden of perfection. We're out from under the burden of trying to be like the Most High, even though we might not realize what's going on. Whenever we're out from that burden, and then we decide to do the right thing by treating each other nice and saying kind things to them, now we're doing the right thing for the right reason. What's the right thing? Treating each other nice. What's the right reason? Not participating in the sin. Knowing that Yeshua performed loving his neighbor as himself. Knowing that Yeshua performed the command. And we are now dead to the sin, as Paul wrote in Romans chapter 6, verse 1. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in the sin that grace may abound? Most High forbid. How shall we that have died to the sin live in it any longer? Live any longer therein. So in other words, once we realize from a messenger that tells us what the truth is, and we don't put ourselves under the law of Moses no more, and we believe what the truth is, that Satan was kicked out for trying to be like the Most High, tricked Eve into trying to be like the Most High, tricked Adam and Eve's children into trying to be like the Most High, has tricked all the rest of the world today in trying to be like the Most High. When we realize and believe that that's what happened, and that Yeshua performed the commandments for us and took our eternal death and rose again to give us back our eternal life, when we believe all that in the story, then we get our eternal lives back. And now we're doing the right thing for the right reason. We're not doing good things because we're trying to love our neighbors as ourselves. We're doing good things because we want to do them. Because it's our choice to do them now. Because we're out from under the burden of the law that tells us, that requires us, the whole world telling us, all come down from the fourth, from Satan to the fourth vow Jesuit to the Pope, that's going around telling everybody we should love our neighbors as ourselves. Although they're telling us this, and they're doing it in a calm voice, you know, as if it's something great to look up to, what they're doing is they're putting a burden on all of mankind So now all of mankind feels the pressure that they must do good. And when you're under the pressure, it causes mankind to get squashed under the pressure. And when you're under pressure, what do you want to do? Push back to get the pressure off. Tell me what to do. Get off me. But the pressure is too hard, and it squashes a man to powder. And so the Pope says, you better do what I do. And if you don't do what he does, he's going to send his police to your house. He's going to take care of you. He says, this is my earth. You better go around love your neighbor as yourself. You better go around and start doing good things. You better make sure you say good things in the workplace. If you don't, we're going to have some anger management courses for you to go to. Or we're going to take you to the courts and put you in a special program. You know? Yeah, they're going to make sure you do good things. All under from the knowledge of the tree of knowledge of good and evil. You know? That's the rule of Satan. That's his rules. Right? Not that Satan created the commandments, and it's not that the commandments are bad. The commandments are good and holy. In fact, Paul also says this. It's the simple fact that that Satan has deceived mankind with these holy commandments and came up with an idea to get mankind to pattern their lives after them in connection with his idea that got him kicked out in the first place. He realized that he could use what the Most High had created, the commandments. He realized he could use that to his advantage to get mankind to fall under its pressure, to pattern their lives after these commandments. Thinking that, oh, these commandments are so holy, and they came from the Most High, so the Most High must think that he wants us to do them. And those commandments were given by the Most High only to show us that we can't do them. They're always there, waiting for the next man on earth to realize that he can't do them. That's the only reason those commandments are there. It's known as the lawful use of the law, as Paul wrote to Timothy, first chapter, First Timothy, second chapter, something like that. He says, we know that the law is good if a man uses it lawfully. In the previous verse, he said, charge these men not to teach the law, teaching of those things that they don't understand. He wrote to the Galatians, he says, if you're going to put yourselves under the law, circumcise your peepees, you might as well just cut the peepees off and obey all the law. he didn't say it all out in that word, but he said, if you put yourself under one part of the law, you're obligated to obey the whole law. And then he says, I would rather that those men that are teaching this, they just cut themselves all the way off. He said, just cut the whole pecker off, man. Take care of the whole problem right now. You know, he's being kind of sarcastic, you know, about the whole situation. You know, not only just to circumcise the head of their penis, just cut the whole thing off. Take care of the whole problem, you know. In other words, what he is probably getting at is that pee-pee is gonna get their minds to be thinking lustful thoughts after the women anyway. So even though you're under circumcision, right? You know, and that was a requirement of the law of Moses. He says there's another requirement of what he was getting at is there's another requirement of the law of Moses that says don't commit adultery. And Yeshua refined that even further. He said even if you think about committing adultery with a woman, or even if you think about lusting after a woman, you commit adultery. So Paul's being sarcastic, as in some of the parables that Yeshua talked about when he said, you know, cut out your eyes. Better to enter hell with one eye than with two. He's like, cut off your hands. Better to enter hell with one hand than two. Most High was being sarcastic, so Paul was being a little sarcastic too when he said, I would rather that they just cut the whole pecker off, man. you know, kind of draw back into the parables of the Most High. Most High is being sarcastic, so I believe Paul was being a little sarcastic when he told them he'd rather they'd cut the whole thing off. Cut the whole pecker off, man. Read it, the book of Galatians. I would rather that they cut the whole thing off, man. Knowing full well that even if they cut the whole thing off, it's not going to keep them from thinking about having relations with, you know, with a woman, yeah. Committing adultery with a woman. It's not going to keep them from going next door to their neighbor's wife, and you know, just because they cut it off, it's not going to keep them from thinking about it. You know? What was the essence of Yeshua and his some of the essence of Yeshua and his parables? He spoke his parables. He was saying it's not the fact that maybe you think you can obey the commandments. He says, even if the thought enters into your mind. Underneath everything that he's saying, although he doesn't come right out and say this, when we read between the lines, we can see what he's really saying is, okay, so he's saying, so what if you were able to obey all the commandments, even though it can't be done? What if? He said, even if you think about calling your brother a fool in your mind, you're guilty of the commandment that says don't murder. He says, even if you lust after a woman in your mind, in other words, even if you just think about it, in other words, as Paul was saying, even if you just chop off the weenie, even if the thought just comes in, even if you ain't even choosing to think about it, just say the thought comes in all by itself, just out of nowhere, out of left field. You're driving down the road, concentrating on the road, all of a sudden, wham, the thought comes in about this woman, and you're thinking about it, wham, for that split second, you're like, where'd that come from? The simple fact that thought came in your mind is proof to you that you cannot be holy like the Most High is holy. Because no thought like that even enters into the Most High's mind. He's all holy. So Paul starts talking about the lawful, telling Timothy about the lawful use of the law. Okay? What's the lawful use of the law? It's there to show a man that he can't be holy. Can't. And that's a wonderful thing. Once a man realizes that, once a man realizes that he doesn't have to pattern his life after loving his neighbor as himself, or pattern his life after karma, the new invented version of loving your neighbor as yourself. What goes around comes around. Do unto others as they'd have them do unto me. What goes around comes around. How is that similar to loving your neighbor as yourself? Well, let's put the definition on record. Okay, what goes around comes around. Okay, in other words, if I treat someone nicely, then niceness will come back to me. It's just like the Tetragrammatron explanation. The Tetragrammatron, according to the Satanists, the Illuminatists, and all the deceived of the earth believe that the Tetragrammatron is regulating everything in the universe. And so it can detect when you're doing bad. In other words, it's operating in the essence of karma. What goes around comes around. So the Tetragrammatron, the shape of the flower of life, the foundation of all the universe, is regulating everything and is in charge of everything. Although it's not, it's just the creation. It's not in charge. there are demons and Satan is making it think that the Tetragrammatron's in charge. And so the demons go throughout the earth upon command of Satan to regulate his rules from his knowledge, from his tree. So this Tetragrammatron detects when we're doing evil. So what goes around, what we do to go around, we cause to have go around, the Tetragrammatron causes to come back on us. Goes around, comes around. The knowledge of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, the knowledge that was developed by Satan. Goes around, comes around. And so the Tetragrammatron can detect when we're doing good. So if it detects when we're doing good and being loving and doing good things all the time, then the Tetragrammatron will make sure that love and life comes to us. Riches and fame and glory and bills canceled and all the other good things. You know, this and that. And the demons make sure that this all takes place under the control of Satan through the fourth vow Jesuits and the Pope and all the people that the Pope has under him that are watching everybody on the earth. Everybody's computer is being watched. They know exactly what we're saying. They know exactly what we're doing. And so whenever they detect somebody going against the knowledge of the Tetragrammatron, right, the people in the neighborhood, they make sure things happen to you. Doing bad. The eyes are out there watching everybody. Satan has the eyes out there watching everybody. All in the name of this Tetragrammatron knowledge. That this Tetragrammatron is the ultimate. That this Tetragrammatron is the creation, is the creator himself. It's not. It's just a creation. Just the creation. There's a far, far, far vast difference between the Tetragrammatron, the creation, and the creator. Far, far. And so what Satan has done is he's taken the Most High, what the Most High has created, just like he took a seed and he mixed a poison seed from other trees, took chemicals and compounds and made a poison seed to grow a poison tree from elements that the Most High created, right? Satan has also taken this Tetragrammatron shape, you know, the foundation of all of life, and caused all mankind to seek after this creation as though this Tetragrammatron is in charge of everything, right? Well, Satan's in charge of that idea. Of using what the Most High has created. You know, I like this story that I read one day. It said this: there was a man who was having a conversation with the Most High, and the man said something like, "Hey, Most High, I want to have a contest with you to prove that I can be like you." And the Most High was like, "Oh, okay, no problem." And the man says, "Okay, let's have a little contest to see who can make the best man, right?" And the Most High was like, "Okay, no problem." And so the Most High sat back and he watched the man. The man started reaching for some dirt on the ground. The man, you know, the Most High sat back and he was watching the man. The man started reaching and he picked up some dirt on the ground for him to start making his man. And the Most High said, "Go create your own dirt." Satan can't create nothing. The Tetragrammatron can't create nothing. Satan is just the creation of the Creator who creates everything. We can't create nothing. We can use what the Creator has created to create stuff, but we can't create any of it. Just like we can't create our eternal life through any of our beliefs, even the belief in this Tetragrammatron that holds the key to eternal life. That's the deception of the devil. Deception of the devil, man. Deception of the devil. The devil is the great deceiver. And I use the word great in context. As in, he can't be great. So he's not really a great at all. I'm being sarcastic there. There's only one that's great. In the whole book of Matthew, the whole theme of the book of Matthew in the Bible, the Gospel of Matthew, has to do with that word greatness. When we have a proper interpretation of how to read it. Greatness, man. So, don't be fooled by all these men running through the earth that are wowing everybody with all this tetragrammatron knowledge and ancient civilizations and this Mayan calendar stuff. And you know, this, this, and that. But, wowing everybody with 500-ton rocks as to how those rocks got stacked on each other and how these pyramids were built with such accuracy. Well, that's easy to understand for someone who knows what really went down in the story of the history of mankind, right? The fallen angels came down and cohabitated with the daughters of men, and they brought knowledge of the universe with them. These angels weren't dumb, and Satan was in charge of all the fallen angels. Satan ain't dumb. They know all kinds of things about the knowledge of the universe. But what they've done is they've taken the knowledge of the universe and they've taken the creation, the universe itself, and caused mankind to be awed by it as though it's to be worshipped. Worshipping the creation rather than the creator. Even to the point of four-footed beasts, wooden objects, statues, you name it. Stars, moons, galaxies, mathematics, shapes, geometrical shapes, anti-gravity. All this stuff is worshipped by all of mankind that have been deceived through Satan to participate in what's called as the sin, trying to be like the Most High. The very thing that got Satan kicked out of eternal life for right from the get-go. Isaiah chapter 14 verse 11 talks about it. Satan wanted to be like the Most High. Tells us what he did. And then Ezekiel tells us why Satan did what he did. Chapter 28 verse 11 tells us because of his beauty. He did what he did because of his beauty. He was a very bright, shining archangel, the anointed cherub that walked among the colored fired stones. He thought a little bit too highly of himself because he was beautiful and bright. He figured his brightness was able to overpower the Most High's brightness. That's what I figure. It doesn't say this in the story, but that's my deduction. He thought a little bit too highly of himself because of his beauty. So he figured he could overthrow the Most High and be the Most High. So he convinced a third of the angels to gather together for the day of battle. And as fast as lightning, they were all thrown out. Bam! Wasn't even a contest. They were like a booger on the Most High's finger, and he just flicked them off just like that. Pfft. Think you can be like me? Yeah. Satan's out forever, man. And he's tricked the whole world with the same idea that got him kicked out. Tricked the whole world. Tricked the whole world, man. Magical trick, man. That's all it is. Satan and his tricks. Satan and his magic, man. His lie, the false knowledge.